like writing parodies because that's the class that you're in. If you want to be somewhere else, by all means, go somewhere else. But if you want to write parodies, this is the class for you. So, a little about me. My name is Daniel Fred. I am a freelance editor. I also write. You'll see a little bit of that later. But the hat I'm going to wear most today is I have a degree in the linguistics of English. And we're going to talk a little bit about what Weird Al does linguistically to make his parodies so darn awesome. So, if you want to write your own parodies, step one is learn from Al. He's the master. What does Weird Al do that makes him so darn fun? Well, linguistically, he employs clever rhymes. He knows his subject matter, and I mean really well. He includes similarities to the original material all over his songs, and we're going to see some of that in the examples here in a minute. He uses every opportunity he can to make a new joke. And finally, he makes fun of multiple things at once. So it's never good enough to just make fun of one thing at a time. Weird Al's going for as much as he can. So let's look at some examples of this. And if you have questions or comments in the middle, just feel free to raise your hand and we'll try and get as many of them as we can. So, clever rhymes. These are some of my favorites. From Living in the Fridge. Tell me, do you think you should be carbonated, fumigated, or cremated? I mean, who thinks of putting these things together? How many people have heard this particular song? Do I have a bunch of Weird Al newbies in here? Alright, we got something. Alright, how about this one? This one's new. Party in the CIA. Alright. Look how many times he gets to rhyme eyes. Remember, rise, spies, neutralize, stabilize, guys, eyes, FBIs. And there's an example of making fun of a second thing at the same time. Because anytime you can bash the FBI when you're pretending to be the CIA, you're gonna do that. Now here we see something interesting. We've got in a complicated song a rhyme scheme that's different. Instead of having Party in the CIA, we've got all of the same eyes. Here in a complicated song, we've got different rhymes in each line. Guest and crest, spy and thigh, gun and one, related and dated, which is possibly the best rhyme of that entire song. Second only to propose and toes, which is, who rhymes this stuff? Weird Al is absolutely brilliant when it comes to rhymes. And there are some resources you have when it comes to rhymes too. You can Google rhymezone.com, and if you type in a word, it will give you a list of all of the other words that rhyme with it. Now, it's not a perfect tool because if you put in town, it'll bring up downtown as a rhyme. Not really. But it does have in that list things that you can actually use. So if you're looking at what is the best, most clever rhyme for this thing that I'm doing, try looking online for different rhyming dictionaries, and they can give you some help. You guys are okay with that? Oh, that was me touching the input.
Oh, okay, so we're good.
Yeah, we're good.
Okay. Just told me this is really bad. Come, you need to go check this.
Oh.
Sorry,
it's all good. All right. Clever rhymes, part two. Can we have the saga begins there? Vader someday later. Now this is not a direct rhyme. It's kind of a false rhyme because D and T are different sounds, but it's close enough because of the vowels on either side of it, that you can get away with that. Now the reason why this is so close is that D and T. The only difference between those sounds is whether or not your vocal cords are moving. Everybody put your hand on your mouth, on your throat here. Say just the sound D. Now duh, duh. Did you feel that vibration with the D? Do it a couple more times. See if you feel it. You'll feel the vibration there. Your vocal cords are moving in the D, but not in the T. This is called voicing in linguistics. And it's the difference between a lot of different consonants. F and V. It's just the vocal cords. Your mouth is making exactly the same sound with both of those. The only difference is your vocal cords moving. B and P are another example of this. S and Z are another example of this. And if you know what those are, you can use those because they're such close sounds that you can use them to make almost rhymes like this that most people aren't really going to get. And it's a great way of expanding that rhyme dictionary to things that sound almost the same. In fact, they sound so close to being the same that you can get away with making a better joke. All right, here's one of my favorites, another tattoo. Now, here we've got some really good stuff going on. The part of me is light up with the intercess. It's like an arsehole the moment that I get undressed. Every job interview, they're just so impressed because I got my ex-wife on my chest. And then he changes the rhyme scheme. So instead of having the whole line to the end of the rhyme, you've got, over here's like Aiken, there's a set of bacon, and a minotaur full of fighting with Satan, next to a little kitty and a zombie, I skate, wait. It's wrong, right? So I'm not quite as good as Al, I know, but still, this is good stuff. And look how many times he is able to rhyme himself. Now, Aiken and Reagan, again, ka-ga. Here's that same false rhyme thing happening here. Now, names are not necessarily going to show up in your rhyming dictionaries when you're looking online for stuff, and yet people are some of the best things you can make fun of. Making fun of people is hilarious. Just ask anyone who's not being made fun of. And here, we're making fun of two completely different people. This is another example of making fun of two things at the same time. Clay Aiken is a pop star and has definite reasons you can make fun of him. Ronald Reagan here, he's not somebody you usually make fun of, but he looks like a zombie, is what Weird Al is saying here. And that's funny, because most of the time we don't think of that when we're thinking about Ronald Reagan. Alright, Word of Crime is my personal favorite. It's quite apparent, your grammar's errant, you're incoherent. Who uses incoherent as a rhyme? Weird Al Yankovic uses incoherent as a rhyme, and it's wonderful. You can do the same kind of thing. Now, you'll notice that if you look at a lot of Weird Al's stuff, he actually ends up using some of these same words to rhyme different times. Another one that I didn't put up here, because I realized, dang it, that's the same clever rhyme, is from an older one called Smells Like Nirvana, where he's making fun of how Nirvana doesn't enunciate their words and you can't tell what they're singing. And he says, we're so loud and incoherent, boy, this ought to bug your parents. And so but he's using incoherent again in a rhyme. And he has these words that he knows are, you know, super like SAT words. These words that, you know, people don't use that often. They make sound really smart, but yet incoherent rhymes with a lot of stuff. And he keeps that in the back of his mind so that he can then go and say, alright, what do I got here that's really gonna be funny? And incoherent is almost always funny when you can rhyme it with something else. And of course, for everybody here at LTUE, the only question I ever thought was hard is, do I ever like the card? It is the best. That line encapsulates white nerdy in one stanza. That is the line that makes that one for me. I laugh harder at that line than anything else. It's fantastic. So notice again that he's used a proper name here. If I type in hard into a rhyme dictionary, it's not going to come up with Picard as a possible rhyme. But it happens here because Weird Al knows his audience extraordinarily well. So what are your favorite rhymes from Al? Anybody got some good examples, some lines you just love? They're the best rhymes you've ever heard.
The Star Wars that I used to sing.
Alright.
The 8th Breaking Song.
Oh, there's a lot of them there. See, I think it's driving me insane. I'd rather have a pitchfork through my brain. Poker Face is fantastic. I don't have any quotes for here, but that one's good too. So I want you guys to just listen to Weird Al's songs now, not just, you know, because they're funny, but listen to him. Pay attention to the words that he's using. Pay attention to the rhymes that he's making. And realize, what else can I rhyme with this word? Why is this working so well? Why is this making me laugh? Because usually when you've got something like incoherent and errant, you're reading some kind of an essay. And essays are boring. And essays are not funny. My gosh, this is funny. And it's funny partially because it is defying your expectation of how this word is going to be used. Remember that and use it. Alright, speaking of knowing your subjects, this one's not a parody, but it's a great example of knowing your subject matter really well. This is one of my favorite songs of Al's, Stop Forwarding That Crap to Me. Now, this song, if you hear the lyrics, it's not that long, right? It's less than a page of lyrics. And yet he manages to know the internet and the means of the internet so well that he has all of this in that song, and this is just scratching the surface. There you go. We got cat pictures, chicken soup for the soul, Snopes, Mr. Rogers. Actually, he didn't do any of that stuff. That's a lie, and the song says so. Top 10 lists, billboards, Bill Gates, Neiman Marcus cookies, and George Carlin quotes that aren't really George Carlin. Like, all of these things that you have, you take an entire, screen to fill up with these different internet memes, he has them all in this one song, and he has rhymed them all together. And the only way he can pull this off is that he knows what's on the internet. He understands what people see on the internet, and what people are upset with on the internet, and what just annoys people on the internet.
I mean, it's like, literary hearts and unicorns, how many people actually care about this?
Yeah, there's gotta be somewhere that wouldn't be there, but hey, it annoys him like all the rest of these things do, and that's why this song is funny. He really knows his stuff. So if you're writing your own parody, you need to know your stuff at least this well. You need to really know what's going on. So let me just ask a couple questions here. Who here is thinking about writing a parody? Show of hands. Wow, I've got a lot of people who are just here for cultural broadening and just wanting to know stuff. That's cool.
I'm here because of Al.
You're here because of Al. Well, I am not Al. I hope that I am not the worst substitute in the world. However, I do want you guys to be able to write parodies if you so desire, because that's what this whole panel's about. So, at any rate, if you're going to write a parody about something, you need to know that something really well. If you want to, and you can see this in other people who have written parodies, one of my favorite non-Al parodies is Provo Utah Girls by Divine Comedy at BYU. You're all laughing. Why are you laughing? Because they nail Provo Utah Girls. And only people who are in Provo Utah or have been in Provo Utah understand how well that song just gets it. And it hits all of these little things, from the hair to the wanting to get married. I mean, everything about Provo Utah.
Talk about making fun of many things at once.
Because making fun of one thing at a time is insufficient.
I was just going to say, I think a lot of us do parodies without even thinking.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you do parody out of someone's name.
Do you have an example of that?
Yes, I do.
Please share.
Okay, so my name is Drain, and I heard people say Drange. I am. CNN Drain, or Vanilli came out with Slam on Drain.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I've heard one.
Yep. My last name is Fred. If you don't think there's puns coming out of that left and right,
trust me.
Alright, so let's see how Weird Al makes fun of many things at once. Alright, we're going back to Pretty Fly for a Rabbi. Daniel, Fred, what's all of this colored lyrics up here? What are all of these color codes? What do they mean?
I'll tell you what they mean. Things Al makes fun of here.
All red is him making fun of a Jewish stereotype, some sort of stereotype about Jews. That's what all the red there is. If you want to haggle, they'll make you a deal. He shops at discount stores. He does his own accounting. He eats bagels. I mean, these are all stereotypes. So, I mean, this is, and you gotta understand that all humor is going to be critical in some way. Humor by its nature is critical. And so it's poking at somebody. It's pointing out a flaw or something that's less than perfect. All humor does this. Doesn't matter if it's stand-up comedy or the Pixar movie or whatever, all humor is critical of something. And so Al here knows his subject well enough that he knows all of these Jewish stereotypes. And he's using them here to comedic effect. Alright, so that's the red. What else is going on? There's two more colors. All the blue is Yiddish. That's how much Yiddish there is in this song. Now, a lot of that's oy vey, which which isn't, you know, super obscure, but it's still there. I mean, he's got Yiddish in darn near every sentence here. There's one sentence that doesn't have it right there, there's one that doesn't have it right there, there's two right there, and one at the very end. Unless you count Hebrew, but that's entered into English. So all of that blue stuff is Yiddish in some way. And he's making fun of the sounds of Yiddish, because it's got a very unique, distinctive sound. And it relates to his other subject matter, of course, it's part of it, but he's getting to make fun of these strange-sounding words and getting to get a laugh out of them, because you don't necessarily know what the word itself means, but you know what the sentence means when he says, he teaches shul, or he's such a mocker because he works his tush just off. I can't even say that right. But he's such a something cool because he worked his rear end off. I mean, I know what it means well enough that I get what the message is, but I also say, okay, he's such a what because he worked his what off? I don't know what that means, and it makes me laugh. So, second thing we make fun of is Yiddish. Third thing, bet you thought all that orange was Yiddish too, though it's not. Sounds like it. Totally not. I thought it was until I started doing this presentation. And then I was, oh, that's not that at all. He's making fun of an obscure Pee Wee Herman character. That these are the magic words that the genie in the Pee Wee Herman show would say. And he's just randomly put them into the song here because they sound like Yiddish. And the people who actually know the Pee Wee Herman character are going to get double the laughs. Everyone else is just like, hey, that's kind of funny, I don't know what that means, it must be Yiddish. I bet that's even funnier if I know what it means. Well, they're right, it is funnier if you know what it means. And it means that you watch the Pee Wee Herman show and you know what's going on with that. So, and that's something else about humor, is that, you know, you want to have a theme, you don't have to know your subject matter well, but then humor is caused when two different conflicting ideas clash in your skull and your brain goes, what? Those don't go together at all. And you have this explosion of what, and that turns into laughter. That's what humor is. And so that's what he's doing right here. You've got all of this, you know, Yiddish-Jewish stereotype, which is all basically one thing. It's like, oh, funny things about Jewish people, funny things about Jewish people. And notice it's all very complimentary about this rabbi. He's not putting anyone down. But yeah, then suddenly you've got random Pee Wee Herman character, and it sounds exactly the same, but it doesn't really belong there. Crutch. Boom. Fine. All right. Any questions so far?
All right. Okay, this is pretty fast. This is good.
Making fun of many things at once is not just an overarching big picture thing. You can do this in a single line. Here are some examples. Double meanings. Back in Jurassic Park, a huge Tyrannosaurus ate our lawyer. But I suppose that proves they're really not all bad. This is structural ambiguity. They. What? They what?
The lawyer
or the Rex? Which one is it? We don't know which one it is. It could work both ways. The fact that T-Rexes eat lawyers, well, that means T-Rexes can't be all bad because they eat lawyers and so do I. But then again, if the T-Rex ate the lawyer must taste good, so I guess the lawyer can't really be all that bad either. It works both ways. Structural ambiguity, because you don't know from the structure of the sentence what is meant. The structure of the sentence doesn't tell you for sure if Al's talking about the lawyers or the T-Rex, and therefore you can interpret it both ways. You probably interpreted it just one way the first time you heard it, and as you know both, you're like, that is brilliant, because he did this on purpose. This is not just him being a bad writer. Most of the time when I see structural ambiguity as an editor, I'm like, oh, cut that out, put in the person's name so I know who the heck you're talking about in your story. This is where he's using that to his advantage. It's brilliant. Example two. Again, pretty fly for a rabbi. When he's doing the bar mitzvah, the parents pay the boil and he gets to keep the tip. We've got kids in the room. So I'm just going to let this one hang. Suffice it to say that the definition of tip could be related to the pay. You know, you can get a tip for doing a service. It could be related to something else. And you don't actually know which one he means here. And so it's just the word there has two meanings, and he has not clarified which meaning he is talking about here. And because it could be both, it's extra funny. Double meanings. Structural ambiguity because of the way the sentence is structured, or lexical ambiguity means you don't quite know what the word means. It could have two meanings, and that makes it funny, because they're both pretty funny. All right. Next thing Weird Al does to make awesome parodies is he uses all his available space to make new jokes. Here is the original lyrics of the song Happy. This is the, you guys have all heard Happy on the radio, right? Okay, good. All right, now how have I color-coded it here? The green is all words and phrases that have not been said before in the song. So the first time you hear, because I'm happy, it's green. Every time a word or phrase is repeated, and I'm going to have more phrases here than actual words, but every time a phrase is repeated, I put it in red. So look how much of this song is original content in green versus repeated content in red. So, I'm not trying to make you feel bad about this song here. This is actually effective for the original song. Happy is meant to be a song that you get up and dance to and that's really easy to sing along with, and it doesn't take you a lot of brain cells to learn the words. And that's what it's trying to do. It's very successful at that. That's not ever what Weird Al is trying to do. Take a look at his parody of Happy. It's color-coded in the same way. Green is stuff that's new that you've not heard before. Red is stuff you've heard previously in the song.
Can you read it? I cannot see.
Yeah. So these are the lyrics of the song. So you've got here, the only thing that Weird Al repeats is the background thing, because I'm tacky. And then at the bridge, bring me shame, can't nothing. Those are the only phrases he repeats in the entire song. And half of that's background noise. That's just backup singers, doing a little extra thing to emphasize what he's doing. Everything else that he talks about is brand new to the very end, to the very last line. And notice that if there's three lines here that are very similar, but they're not the same. At the end of each of the verses, he says something that if you're okay with that, you might be tacky. But it says if you're okay with that, you might just be tacky too. If you think that's just fine, then you're probably tacky too. If you don't think that's bad, guess what? Then you're tacky too. So I probably should have read it. I probably should have made read you're tacky too, but there's a probably, and there's a just might be, and there's different words, and it's not the same phrase. And he has changed it, and in this particular case, it's re-emphasized, like, you just might be tacky. You're probably tacky. Guess what? You're definitely tacky now. So he's making it stronger each time he goes through, and that's just good songwriting technique in the first place, by changing things up so that it's almost the same, but it gets bigger and more empathetic as it goes along. So the point I'm trying to make here is Weird Al has lots of green, okay? He uses all the space that he possibly can to make new jokes. And once he's out of space and he's not making any more jokes, boom, song's over. Happy actually has, you can see that the text is a little bit smaller, it does its bridge twice and has an extra chorus at the end. If you're singing along in the car, Weird Al's song cuts off about 30 seconds early. Because he's out of jokes and he's not going to tell anymore, he's done. Alright, you guys ready for step two? Now you get to practice. Alright, I'm going to confess that what's going to come up on the screen now. I hope you can read it. I will read it. I will read these things to you if I need to. I was hoping a little bit bigger space, but anyway. What we're going to have here are some of my own parodies. Now, I'm not as good as Al, and that's okay, because that means there are things here for you guys to critique. I want you guys to look at my parodies and say, all right, how well did he do? Did Daniel Friend do as well as Al? The answer is no, I did not. There are some things that even I know are wrong with these parodies that I want you guys to find. So keep in mind, you're looking for clever rhymes, knowledge of subject matter, similarities to the original, use of space to make new jokes, and multiple targets for the humor. So I'm going to read these lyrics to you, and you guys are going to tell me how well did he do. All right. So number one, Everybody know Coldplay's Paradise? Anybody not? He's passingly familiar with the song. Okay. So there's the original lyrics. Paradise. So, I'll read this one to you. I could sing, but my throat is getting a little bit scratchy, and I don't really want to sing over the actual singer because I don't have a karaoke trick. So, always thought I would win when I played Paladins, but the GM said it was cheap and put my gear out of reach. I had a paradise. Repeated paradise, paradise, paradise. Blew on them and closed my eyes. Whoa, 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 whoa. I met your little critical. Next, I played Angry Orcs launching raids on the world, but I didn't see that mage coming, and his spell hit me without warning. Saving throws are never fun when you're at a minus one. If I failed, I was done. My GM grinned up at me and winked his eye, and he said, get out of this, go on and try. You got a pair of dice. Roll. I rolled my pair of dice. And then what I've done here is instead of the la 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 stuff that he does, I'm like, come on, 20, come on, 20, come on, 20. And when they came to rest, his surprise, they had their 20s facing up, and he could not believe his eyes. Those are my paradise! And then just kind of repeating that all the way through, I said my paradise, I rolled, rolled, they got my paradise, roll that natural critical. So, all right. There's a pair. It's not quite as good as Alice. Why is it not as good as Alice? Yes?
A lot of it is repetitive, like all the paradise stuff, the rolls.
Right. Absolutely. You're exactly right. I have not used my space to make new jokes as well as Alice here. All of these paradise, I mean, it's basically, I'm holding, trying to hold one joke over a 3-minute song. That the way that Coldplay sings Paradise kind of sounds like pair of dice. And I mean, it's a funny enough joke, but it kind of gets a little old by that second to last chorus there. So I'm not using my space as well as I could. All right?
But there's a couple of ways that you can fix that.
How so?
First, rewrite it, or you can cut more out of it. We're out of it in the southern where it's 30 seconds shorter.
Exactly.
At least 2 ways to solve that.
Anything else? Other thoughts? What else could we do? What else could be done better here in this area? Yes?
Nothing breaks the scenario.
Uh-huh.
Everything in this one scenario, if you're rolling your dice for the point of order, sorry, I don't quite. But nothing breaks the scenario, at least that I caught. So having just something randomly that fits in there is one of the most iconic things I think about the Rouse stuff.
Like those Pee Wee Herman lines,
yeah.
Tree of Life or Rouse. I don't have any of this. This is not making fun of multiple things at once. I'm making fun of one thing, one joke, and that's it. And it's not a bad joke, but it could be a lot better if I had a second thing. Maybe I'm rolling dice for Yahtzee or it's something else. I don't know what, but
you can bring in and make fun of me. Formal professional, like Las Vegas gamers.
That's an idea. Yeah.
I think also, I mean, you're making fun of like the Dungeons and Dragons type of gameplay. We'll bring in other elements of that culture. You know, mm-hmm. Who are they being? What kind of clothes are they wearing? Make fun of the hat that the guy is wearing. And, you know,
I like it.
Oh my gosh, what to wear.
There you go.
Throwing off your mojo.
Could you go back to the original paradise saying, oh, I'm so happy I'm in paradise, and then you just flip the paradise?
Use both meanings.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's also a good idea. Alright, so there's one other thing that you guys might not know enough about, but and when it comes to knowing your subject matter well, and I don't honestly know a single saving throw where I would roll 2d20s. That's kind of funky. I mean, I'm not saying it's impossible because Dungeons and Dragons has a rule book that's this thick if you put them all together, but that's not a normal situation where you roll 2d20s as a saving throw. So there's also a subject matter knowledge thing going on here, but it's obscure enough that I probably can get away with it for most people except the really hardcore D&D players, but they're the ones I want to love this thing the most.
Or use part of the song to build up and explain how rare or not.
That's possible. It would take a lot of lyrics to do do that. Now, part of the reason that this is happening is we'll get to it a little bit later, is that the original song is super repetitive too. The original song does not have a lot of lyrical space for me to do something like set that up. There's not a lot of space to do that here. So I'm limited by the fact that I parodied this song that just has this stuff going on. And you can only do as much as the original song allows you to do. Yeah?
There's like a whole paragraph between time, like, and coming, morning.
Yeah, those aren't super good rhymes, are they? I could have better rhymes there, you're right. Like I said, these are meant to be flawed, so it's okay. All right, next one. Santa Claus is coming to town. I think you guys all know this one.
Here's my version.
You better not plot, you better not spy, you'll probably get shot. I'm telling you why. NSA is coming to town. NSA is coming to town. They've got a hit list, they're checking it twice. Security risks are not treated nice. They see you when they're sleeping, they know when you're awake, they've hacked into your cell phone, so be good for goodness sake. Now, wait a minute. The original has the little tin horns and little toy drums, rage cheeks, and rummy tum tums.
I don't have anything.
Your turn. what could we work into this here? We don't have to actually get a whole verse down. We don't have to write this down and make it awesome. But what could we put into that?
Yeah. Like spy satellites.
Ooh, I like that. Sorry, what was that over here? Okay. Guns are pretty generic. Maybe we can think of some goal there, yeah.
Things like your kits or other cybersecurity.
Cybersecurity stuff. Now, guns is too generic, but what if we had, like, with silenced, and then we name the specific type of gun that the CIA uses.
Silenced and real things.
There you go. Okay, CIA. Yes.
Throwing men in black stereotypes?
Yes.
That's
really good. That is really good.
Men in black right there.
I like that.
That's a good one, yeah.
Another one good one would be like the TSA type of X-ray machines and security locks, I don't know.
Okay, now this is one thing you can do when you're writing a parody. You can think of all of these things that we've just named that have to do with the CIA or the NSA, and WikiLeaks and silence guns and tanks, and we've got a list of stuff. Let's see how much of that stuff we can fit into this verse, this rhyme scheme. We've got five lines here. How much of that can we fit in there? Where are the clever rhyming words in this list? And how do we fit those together in something that actually makes sense as a sentence when I sing it?
That's how you do parodies.
Read the original.
Huh?
Read the original.
The original, with little tin horns and little toy drums, Rudy Toot Toot and Rummy Tum Tums, Santa Claus is coming to town.
There's a lot of
Yeah. So if we wanted, if there was like with buzzing wire hacks and like and tat attack Tommy guns or something like that, you can use some of that original stuff and then do something that's very similar in style, and that is extra funny. Get extra points if you can do something that's similar in style to the original, because, again, similarities to the original song. And they're extra funny.
Alright.
Just to finish it off, the spooks of Nancy Land will have a jubilee. They're gonna read the Patriot Act all around the Christmas tree. So.
Alright, I said that one might be my best one. This next one is still decent work.
Alright. Love Runs Out by One Republic. Does everybody know what this song is?
Yeah.
I see some confused faces. Let's take a listen.
Making you run and we'll feel alright. We'll feel alright 'cause we're working.
you got the melody, you know what's going on. Those of you who actually know the lyrics are gonna like this a lot better. Alright, this is Doe Runs Out. I'll buy your lights, your watch, your firstborn son. I'll buy a Lamborghini and a new Xbox One, and it feels just like I'm a sheep tonight till my dough runs out. Till my dough runs out. I'll be buying things, I don't have a doubt, till my dough runs out. Alright, can you guys see this at all? Can you guys see the lyrics here that I put up? Alright, so look at these things and see how I'm trying to keep what's going on with this original one. Now, this is the fun part of this. I really like my new version. Not that it's the most clever or inventive or amazing thing, but when I hear the original one, it's kind of like, hey, these lyrics, I don't even know what they mean, honestly. But now I've got something where I'm talking about a story about a guy who just goes and spends all of his money until at the end of the song, his credit score is double digits because he spent everything that he has. So give me a look at this. How did I do on the things that Weird Al does better?
This is more just kind of common, but I think Weird Al sometimes takes kind of like lines that are easy to mishear from the original song and twists them into something in his
yeah.
Which I don't know if you did in this one because it's hard to analyze quickly, but
yeah, we were a little bit running out of time. I wanted to give you guys a little chorus to think about like we did with the last song. But we don't quite have the time. Now, one of the ones that I've done here is, that's kind of like what I'm talking about is, the original line is, there's a maniac out in front of me, got an angel on my shoulder, and Mephistopheles. Bleh. What does that even mean? I know what it means. I'm saying that's one of those words that you don't hear that very well. So I've been like, I'm a maniac on a spending spree. I've been doing this ever since I won the lottery. It's a lot easier to hear. It's not quite others. The same mishearing that we're talking about with Weird Al, but it's something. So I want you guys to take a look at this and also to just realize that if you're going to do a parody of something, you better like the music. Because if you don't want to have that beat in your head all day, you don't want to be doing a parody of this song at all. Luckily, I don't mind. Alright, so, step three, since we got 3 minutes left, try it yourself and have fun. So, how do you choose songs to parody? You want them to be well known. If nobody knows this song that you're making fun of, nobody's gonna laugh. They're not gonna know what you're talking about, and they're not gonna have a reason to listen to it. The more well known the song is, the better the parody is going to perform. And that's, sorry, I don't have time. And that's why Weird Al is always parodying these top 40 hits, because he knows that people are gonna know the song and they're gonna react to it.
No context problems.
He's got a next way to choose songs. Make sure you got a catchy tune. You really want to have something that's going to stick in people's ears, that's going to get them to be thinking about whenever they hear that music. You want to think about your lyrics because they're funnier than the original ones. Next, and this is the mistake I made with Parodies, you want lots of lyrics. You want there to be lots of space for you to work in so you can make fun of stuff. If you have just really limited lyrics, it's harder to get as many jokes, it's harder to set them up right, it's harder to get all the things you need to do. So lots of lyrics are better for parodies than songs with very few lyrics, like Parodies ones. Finally, for goodness sake, again, make it something you like. If you don't like the song, I mean, the one way you can maybe start to like the song is if you parody the song and your new lyrics are so good that you just love that. But you still gotta like the music underneath it, because if you just like, oh, I can't stand this, you're not going to love it enough to actually put in the work of listening and re-listening and re-listening to it to get the parody right. How do you choose topics? You want something that's got a broad appeal. If people don't understand what you're talking about, the parody's not gonna work. The parody has to be something that enough people are gonna know enough about that they're gonna get your jokes. If you're going into just, like I had one that was about D&D, but if I'm going into just Pathfinder, just the rules about bards and Pathfinder, that is way too specific and nobody's gonna get that. Even if there is funny stuff there, if only 5 people get it, it doesn't matter. Right, we want a topic that works with the rhyme scheme. So there's a line, if there's a word at the end of the line that rhymes with stuff, it's like, oh, that they use that word all the time in this, that's a good start. And you want something that's got funny sounding jargon. The better vocabulary you have to work with, the better your jokes are gonna be, and the more fun it's gonna be for you. Alright. And to close it, remember Al's secrets. Doing what Al does will make your parodies funnier. So
employ clever rhymes. Know your subject matter. Include similarities to the original material. Use every opportunity to make new jokes and make fun of multiple things at once. And have fun! Because if you don't think it's funny, nobody else will. Just because you think it's funny doesn't mean everybody else will think it's funny too, but if you don't think it's funny, no one else thinks it's funny. Thank you.
It's just copyright. There's no copyright.
That's what, no, I'm not with Parodies. With Parodies, that's a transformative work, and it's commenting on the original, and it is a protected form of free speech.
Oh, okay.